Thank you so much for joining us today. I'm excited to welcome you to this webinar, Leveraging Historic Federal Funding. Really excited for today's conversation, an opportunity to dig in. My name is John Harper. I'm a managing director here at FSG. I wanna start with just a huge thank you to everyone that's joining today. We are overwhelmed that we had over 1,300 registrants. So really excited to dive into today's conversation. I have to leave by doing a huge thank you to my co-authors of the article that we referenced earlier this year, directors Aaron Sullivan and Chris Carlson. I also wanna do a huge thank you to our panelists, who you'll be hearing much more from in the coming hour or so. And also a huge thank you to the FSG Marketing and Communications team. We would not be here without all the coordination that they're doing in the background. So just wanna leave with a huge thank you to all of those folks. On our next slide, have a little bit of background about FSG. So we are a global nonprofit consulting firm. We work primarily with foundations and corporations to reimagine the ways that they think about social impact. Through our work, we do a mix of customized consulting services, innovative thought leadership, and creating learning communities, not too dissimilar from the ones that we have here today. So our belief that that combination of those three things is really how we can activate our impact moving forward. Again, my name is John Harper. I'm a managing director here at FSG. Have the pleasure of working across our client segments, also across issue areas. And so that's part of what has me particularly excited for today's conversation. On the next slide, we have a little bit of background, a bit of throat clearing, as we all must do at the beginning of these convos. We want to hear from you throughout. So our goal today is to do about 60 minutes of conversation with our panelists, and then we'll save 30 minutes for Q&A at the end. Throughout, I invite you to share your questions in the Q&A box. Also invite folks to upvote the questions that you find most interesting. We'll be leveraging those as we get into that Q&A portion of the conversation. I also invite folks to continue to engage in the chat, as you already have. I have a few colleagues that are hoping to moderate that forum as well. Now, I want to acknowledge a lot of folks are here to learn about different funding opportunities, to dive into the details. And while we have a significant portion of time set aside, I know we're not going to satiate all of the desire for the details that you might want to cover. So two things I'll lift up. Number one, my colleagues here at FSG and I have prepared a key resource list that provides more information about much of the key funding streams that we'll be discussing. We'll also have slides and information available for you afterwards. And I would say, let's continue the conversation. Today is certainly the first of these that we want to explore, but we're hoping to do more in the future. And so more to come on that topic. A few more tech tips before we dive in. Number one, the recording and slides will be available on fsg.org. We'll also send you an email with all of that information as soon as we log off. Number two, live captions are automatically on. If you want to turn them off, go to live transcript in your webinar menu and choose hide subtitle. And then if you have any technical difficulties throughout or need help with anything, please share in the chat or email info@fsg.org. Again, I have a colleague that is managing that inbox in case you run into any challenges. So with that, I would say let's go ahead and dive into the conversation. But before I turn it over to our panelists, I'd love to get a little bit of color for what brings us here today. We think back, last year, federal legislation authorized more than about $2 trillion of federal funding. Three big acts are at the core of this: the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act, Inflation Reduction Act, and of course the CHIPS Science Act. Now, importantly, all of this funding is not just loans and grants. A significant portion is going to be private tax incentives and formula grants. But even with that caveat, if you move on to the next slide, what we start to understand is that with those three grants, those three opportunities, as well as a wide variety of state surpluses and other funding streams, many of which we'll learn more about today, what we have is an unprecedented level of funding that is now flowing into community, right? Now, to be clear, these are multiple sources, multiple funding mechanisms. It's going to flow from different entities, including workforce development agencies, the Department of Commerce, in some instances, the Department of Energy. In many ways, these will be competing timelines, right? In some instances, we have corporates trying to navigate community benefit agreements. In other instances, we'll have competitive sort of local grants that have to play out. Now, to be clear, the funding supporting a range of goals. We're trying to do things like increase global competitiveness or even address climate change. Yet they all share common aspirations to advance equity and opportunity, to a desire to jumpstart more equitable economic development and more inclusive growth. And so my colleagues and I have been asking, considering these distinctions and all these tensions, what can we actually do to collectively get ready, right? There's a lot that's going to be playing out here and a lot is still unknown. What should we be thinking about in this moment? Now, we've been talking to lots of folks over the course of the past few months, and we're already starting to answer that question with at least two concepts that are already showing up today in our conversation. Number one is a recognition that everyone has a role, right? This opportunity is going to cross issue areas. I'm a big fan of the Audre Lorde quote that there is no single issue movement because we don't live single issue lives. Similarly, in this moment, no one player will be able to do all of this. So whether you're coming to this from a climate justice or an economic opportunity or an entrepreneurship lens, or whether you find yourself as a nonprofit practitioner, perhaps you're in the corporate halls, or perhaps you're a foundation player, or perhaps you're in the city or state government, we are all going to have to play a role in order to ensure that we are moving this work forward. Really excited for our panelists today that represent a few of those different perspectives and what that means for the conversation. And then number two, which feels important, increasingly important, particularly over the debt ceiling negotiations and other things, is to recognize that there's much more here beyond a single opportunity. Our conversation at FSG started because we were looking at the CHIPS Science Act. But as we started to explore other opportunities, we realized there's a lot more coming for folks. It can be tempting to be driven towards one specific opportunity. Let me apply for this grant because I see it now. We would posit, how do you think about that collective, that inclusive, that intentionally inclusive infrastructure that enables the community to be responsive to multiple opportunities as they continue to unfold moving forward? That's what we're hoping to lift up a few examples of today. With that context, I'm really excited to introduce our panelists. Had the honor of getting to know these folks over the past few weeks and really feel like a kid on Christmas to dive into today's conversation. Quickly, we have sort of three dynamic leaders joining us today. Number one, Melanie Allen, co-director of the Hive Fund for Climate and Gender Justice. Kendra Lewis, Managing Director of the Community Economic Mobilization Initiative at the Center for Sierra Health Foundation. And Chanell Scott Contreras, Executive Director of ProsperUs Detroit and the Build From Within Alliance. These dynamic leaders are looking at this opportunity from different angles. We got a funder, we got a convener, we got a nonprofit, and from different areas of the country. We got the Southeast. I'm a Georgia boy, so excited to have the Southeast present. We have California, and we have Michigan. I'm a firm believer that we do our best learning at these intersecting points. And I've already learned so much from our folks preparing for today. So let's go ahead and dive in. I'm actually gonna get started with Melanie. I'd love for you to share a bit about your work at Hive Fund. Which of these funding streams that we talked about are you tracking to these days? And how are you helping folks get ready? What does this mean for the climate justice movement?
Well, hello, and thank you for that overview and that warm introduction, John, and the invitation to join you today. It is an honor to be in conversation with you, Kendra, Chanell, and thanks to all of you all who found time to join us as well. My name is Melanie Allen, and alongside Aaron Rogers, I'm one of the founding co-directors of the Hive Fund for Climate and Gender Justice. The Hive Fund is a specialized intermediary that raises money and makes grants to groups working to accelerate an equitable transition to cleaner, more renewable energy, while also reining in the dirty energy in the US South, where clean energy opportunities and pollution levels are high and funding levels have traditionally been low. We also work to elevate the positional power of women, particularly women of color in this region. Though this history and present impact are often overlooked, what we know is that the South is rich in vision, strong in leadership, and has been vital to any movement for change that this country has seen. And we think that this change, particularly this energy transition, is gonna be no different. The Hive Fund provides multi-year general operating support to more than 120 grantee partners. And our priority states are Texas, Louisiana, Georgia, your home state, John, North Carolina, where I'm joining you from, which is also my home state, and South Carolina. And these states together contribute more than 20% of the nation's climate pollution. And what we know is that there is not going to be a true and durable climate action that does not go through this region. When we talk about this moment, I always like to start with gratitude because it was a powerful push by youth leaders, environmental justice, and climate justice advocates that really reframe climate solutions from something that's, you know, just talking about numbers that a lot of people don't understand, or parts per million, to really thinking about the way that it intersects with our everyday lives. So thinking about climate solutions as clean energy investments, as jobs, as economic justice, as implications on our health and just everyday livelihood, and really created this historic moment for us to change. For us to see this watershed change. Last year, alongside FSG, our team went out and spent the summer talking directly to about 70 of our grantee partners in their communities. And the one thing that we heard more than anything else is that they have powerful visions for change and what their communities can look like. And unfortunately, they're not often asked what their visions are. They're often brought in late and at the last minute. And so when we knew that or heard, that the IRA had passed after all of these years of championing and hard work, we saw it as an opportunity alongside IJA, the CHIPS Act, and many other acts that have been passed with this administration for organizations to move from like planning and visioning to powerful implementation. As you mentioned, John, what we also know is that there's a great deal of information to try to get your arms around in this moment across multiple bills, but probably most importantly, across so many different agencies. And what we heard from our grantee partners and felt ourselves was a sheer amount of overwhelm at the amount of information. What we know about federal funds is that they often flow to those who have gotten them before. And one of the things that we are most excited about is Justice 40 commitment, what we see as, environmental justice executive orders that, have said that this time we want to do things differently. And as funders that are committed to doing things differently and making sure that communities that have been historically under-resourced get their fair share, but also knowing that they are solutionaries, that they've got really, really strong visions for how we can do this successfully. What we've seen as our goal and our role in this moment has been to take organizations that are shovel worthy and moving them to this place of shovel ready, because so often federal funds flow directly to the shovel ready. They follow the path of least resistance. And so, that has really been one of the ways that Hive Fund has been looking at our work in this moment. We're taking a place-based approach because what we know is that while a lot of this is happening at the federal government, the proof is going to be in the pudding on the ground and how it happens in communities. So I'm going to ask for my slides and I'll talk through a little bit about what we're focusing on and what that looks like on the ground. So this is an IRA opportunity, and this is Ajulo Otho, one of our grantee partners at InnerWell Solutions in rural North Carolina. I love this photo because it shows the optimism that she's seeing in her rural community, where she's been able to not only bring solar, but to bring communities that are traditionally left out of these conversations ownership in the solar that's being built in her community. We're going to focus our work, and we have decided to, we had to kind of narrow it down, focus our work on EPA climate pollution reduction grants, environmental and climate justice block grants, and also greenhouse gas reduction fund. And so that first suite, those first three are all EPA programs, but we're also looking more broadly at clean energy resources in rural areas and then community benefit plans. And I guess we'll go to the next slide. I talked a little bit about our place plus approach. And what that means for us is that we're building off of the infrastructure that already exists in place. We have strong ecosystems that have been working at advocacy and power building, organizing, and even already doing some work to make their communities more resilient. And so our investment has really been on what does it look like to bring these organizations into closer and deeper relationship? And what does it mean to support them with the infrastructure that they need, not only to be able to apply for individual federal opportunities that may arise, but to have a shared vision so that they can begin to apply collectively. And so that, the benefits that communities feel will be greater than the sum of their parts. We have focused primarily in kind of four priority areas. We'll end up with 10 regions, but we started in Houston, and that was about, I guess, almost a little over a year ago, where we have a community of about 20 grantee partners working in Northeast Houston, and we're able to really zero in on their priorities. They have three main priorities, resilience, which is home motorization, resiliency hubs. What does it look like to have, you know, battery storage and maybe some microgrids that are supporting this community that's historically been underserved and left behind? Clean energy, which is, you know, having access to residential solar, having access to ownership, and also just in their homes and their dwellings, having increased energy efficiency that is connected to homes that are safer, healthier, and more resistant to flooding. And then last is low carbon mobility. Transportation is going to be huge. And so what we've heard from communities is this question about how they can help shape that. And the work that we've been doing is working to you know, prioritize, really tease through what shared community visions look like so that they can be in the position in the driver's seat, not only for what they apply for the funds that are going directly to communities, but also to be in deep conversation with the local governments that are going to be applying for funds. We're also building this work in Atlanta, in New Orleans, and in rural Northeast North Carolina, and we have about 6 other locations that'll come online. I'll keep moving through because I know we've got a few other conversations to have, but wanted to highlight, this is Ms. Bridget Murray, pictured here. She's in Houston, achieving community tasks successfully is her organization, and she's been able to tap into some of these EPA funds early to get resources for air quality monitors that she and her community have been working for many, many years. And, you know, they're a near-port community. They deal with the pollution of so many industries that accompany having a port in your backyard. And so we're really excited that they've been able to be successful. And that'll be, you know, one of the foundations for future success that's happening in Houston and in our near-port communities that we're supporting throughout the region. That's just one way that folks can use the environmental justice community funds that are coming through. We'll go to the next slide. Greenhouse gas reduction fund is going to be critical. One of the things that, you know, the federal government is really investing in is lowering costs of clean energy through scale. And the Greenhouse Gas Reduction Fund is going to put billions of dollars into communities' hands, hopefully billions of dollars into organizations that are going to invest in communities. And what we're doing is hopefully supporting organizations so that community organizations that have historically lent to communities, that have done, you know, financial work and been financial assets in communities, particularly disinvested in communities, are seen as viable options for our vehicles for moving these greenhouse gas reduction funds. We've helped to stand up and see the Texas Clean Energy Fund, supporting North Carolina Clean Energy Fund. Before we came online, I think there was only one what we would call Green Bank in the US South. And so I've been really helping to build that infrastructure, but making sure that there's equity at the center of each of those that we're investing in. And then supporting a national infrastructure, making sure that equity, climate, and clean energy are all coming together and not leaving anything behind. And then we'll move to the next slide, the final slide, which is climate pollution reduction grants. States are required to collaborate with community organizations. And so one of the things that we're doing is working with communities to make sure that they're prepared to come in as true partners. I like to say that unfortunately right now, the ceiling is the floor when we think about, you know, what communities expect when they're entering these partnerships or these relationships with governments or with municipalities or other partners. And so one of the things that we're working with communities to do is to create their own criteria for what it looks like for them to be signed on as a community partner or for a community plan that will be required to get many types of federal funds going forward, particularly Department of Energy funds. And I know that I think at or over my time. So I'm gonna stop here and hand it back to you, John, but excited to be in conversation with you all further today.
Thanks so much, Melanie. I appreciate you for sharing the additional information. Also appreciate you for bringing the faces and the names of folks actually leading the work. It feels so important for this conversation. So really grateful for that. I'm actually going to turn and I think we're going to dive into a few bit of what you lifted up. So excited to get to the conversation portion. Kendra, I'm going to turn it over to you to share a bit about the Community Economic Mobilization Initiative. What does this work look like in California? I think you're going to walk us through some of the state level funding streams that you all are working through. And how do these dollars, how are they supporting economic development? Share more.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you. I'm just excited to be part of an amazing panel to talk about this work. Again, my name is Kendra Lewis. I'm the managing director of CEMI, which is the Community Economic Mobilization Initiative here in California, the very large state of California, the fourth largest, we have the fourth largest economy in the world. And our, believe it or not, CEMI is an unprecedented initiative in California. And so we're excited about this work. It is housed in the center, which is a nonprofit arm of the Sierra Health Foundation. Next slide. And so really quickly, who we are, we lead with community. We have our CEO, Chet Hewitt, and the president of the center, Kaing Hang, are just amazing individuals to work with on a daily basis. But basically, this is what we bring is people and ideas for the collective. And CEMI is only a year old. The concept was designed and developed by Chet and Kaing in this moment, in this historic moment that we're in as it relates to the federal funding, the unprecedented amounts of money that are going to be going all over the nation. But California is expected to receive $160 to $190 billion. And I'm sure relative to other states, you know, that I mean, it's a lot of money in general, especially considering it's not part of our general budget. And it is money that we are hoping that will really transform our communities. And we are definitely a leader in that in our area. Just to note, the Sierra Health Foundation has a region in the Sacramento area and up to the Oregon border. So we have a very kind of limited area in the state. However, my initiative is statewide. Next slide. And so what CEMI is timely. There's a quote from Chet in a presentation not long ago, and he said that patience is for the privileged. And that really has stuck with me because this is a moment that we don't have time considering how our communities have been designed historically throughout the nation, but especially here in California. And so really the purpose of CEMI has been to work at the grassroots level throughout the state of California in communities and regions in hopes that they can fully participate in this moment as it relates to funding. As many states, California is extraordinarily complicated and bureaucratic. It has been designed and built to not be inclusive as progressive as we have evolved to become. I'm a native California. I live in California and I've lived in California almost my entire life. My grandparents migrated from the Jim Crow South to the San Francisco Bay Area. And so there's been a lot of work for many, 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 many decades that we have been trying to do on the ground to ensure that there is more inclusive economies throughout our state. The core part of what the work is for CEMI is we have a portfolio of about $20 million, and we are hoping to grow that in the future. That is focused on nonprofit organizations building capacity, because what we find is our CBOs, especially in our BIPOC communities, do not have the basic infrastructure needed to fully participate, one, two, at a faster pace, and don't have access to the resources. And so the other part of CEMI, which is really just incredible for me to participate, is our Technical Assistance Center, which we call TARC. It is led by Chris Benner and Dr. Manuel Pastor, who are just innovative and thought partners in this, along with Policy Link, who helped us to design this. Our center is up and running now. And as we are going into a new phase of this work, we will be announcing our grantees very shortly. We have a combination of a pooled amount of money in the portfolio, as well as we have some of our funding partners who made donor advised grantees. Next slide. So what's important to know about how CEMI works and how what we're doing in California, we are partners with the state of California in SERF, and SERF stands for Community Economic Resilience Fund. I'm not sure if you can see all the wording, but basically our governor decided that he wanted to do something unprecedented as well. And what we have are 13 regions throughout the state of California that is designed to really to help on the ground, on the grassroots level as well, more inclusive economic communities. And so we're a big partner with a governor. In fact, we meet on a monthly basis. In fact, last week, we were just recently told that CEMI, the CEMI initiative is going to be a priority in this project, which is unprecedented. And I say that the combination of grant making, of our technical assistance center, as well as our power building component, is what our state needed in a partner in order to ensure that collectively we can build, that we can participate, our communities can participate in the monies. It is my understanding that the money has to be spent by 2026, which means in grassroots communities and communities of color, we're already behind. And so it is our job and our work that we work as fast as we can with grantees. And so what we're very much focused is on geographic. There's parts of our state that really are isolated, like the North State, the Inland Empire, and parts of the Central Valley. They are under-resourced in ways differently than our urban areas like San Diego, Los Angeles, and San Francisco Bay Area. So I'll just kind of stop there because I know we've got a lot of other presentations and talking to you, but this is just an overview of what CEMI is in the state of California. We're really excited about it. SURF was launched at our foundation with the 2-day workshop with the representation of every single SURF region. And we will be working together even more so because from a funding perspective, we want to make sure that as many of the gaps that there aren't as many gaps. We don't want a lot of overlap, which happens, as was mentioned, far often the folks at the table get the lion's share of the food, and our grassroots communities do not barely get to participate. So we're reimagining what our California is going to look like in this moment and really redesigning how we work now and how we move forward.
Thank you so much for that, Kendra. I really appreciate the presentation. I think the part that really stands out for me is what you all are doing to the ways in which California is really out front, right? I'm excited for today's national conversation because it brings up a lot of examples that others across the nation can now mimic and recreate. And this feels like a really powerful example of that for today's convo. Thank you for offering. I'm going to turn it over to our last panelist today to give us a bit of intro and introduce us to ProsperUs Detroit. So often when we think about these opportunities, we think about sort of what's the role of foundations? What's the role of nonprofits? What's the role of city government? And I was recently at a panel session that Chanell served on, and what folks in that panel said is actually our entrepreneurs are the community leaders that we have to be investing in. And so it felt inappropriate to only be thinking about this from a nonprofit perspective or from a funder perspective. What does this actually mean for the entrepreneurs on the ground? How should we be thinking about engaging them more effectively? So with that, Chanell, I'd love for you to share a bit about ProsperUs Detroit and your work around supporting small businesses as community leaders and how you're thinking about this moment for entrepreneurs.
Thank you so much, John. And thank you everyone for having me. It's truly an honor. So I represent both ProsperUs Detroit, which is our local initiative focused on supporting entrepreneurs working in low to moderate income communities of color, as well as the Build From Within Alliance, which is a national alliance with that same focus on supporting entrepreneurs in neighborhoods, particularly low to moderate income neighborhoods. And I serve as the board chair. I'm the executive director of ProsperUs, and I'm the new board chair of the Build From Within Alliance. You can go to my next slide, please. So you'll notice two distinct color schemes. The purple here represents our work at ProsperUs. And I want to give you a little sense of what we do. Our focus is on supporting entrepreneurs, and we are focused on those entrepreneurs that have the most difficult and most difficult experience and also the most barriers to success. We know that opening a business in a low to moderate income community, coming from maybe a low to moderate income household, presents many challenges. But we know that opportunity, though it doesn't reach every community has talent and skill and the ability to build businesses from within. So we look at our model in two ways. On the left here, you'll see our funnel, which describes our support services. At the top of our funnels are training and education. We make it widely accessible because we know that that entry point is so important to reaching entrepreneurs who have been so excluded from supports in their communities. We also layer in personal financial coaching, business services projects and coaching as well, access to capital through our microloan program, and then continued practical assistance or technical assistance as it's often referred to. We think this funnel creates on-ramps, but those on-ramps aren't meaningful if they're not actually rooted in community. So on the right side of the slide, you'll see our hub and spoke or our network-based approach to entrepreneurship. ProsperUs is there in the center, but the white dots represent our community partners. We partner with community development organizations and other groups that are rooted in the communities that they serve. They're able to advocate and hold us accountable to the needs of their communities. And they also are partners that we invest in, right? We're not just asking for referrals for them to do it on the side, but we pay them. We're partners in agreement where they provide hosting of our training and education, they recruit for our cohorts, and they are a continuous bridge or trusted connector from the community into our services. We partner with several organizations across the city of Detroit, also Hamtramck and Highland Park. And that's led to all of those green dots that you see there, which are entrepreneurial training clients. Purple represents our technical assistance or coaching clients. And then red is our access to capital. So you can see how it takes a lot of business support services rooted in community to reach and deploy capital in a way that's accessible. And I'm excited about some of the outcomes that we have related to our capital. But before I get there, I just want to share that for every dollar that we invest through lending, we spend $2.50 in those additional support services. And that's why we're able to see, or that's part of that equation that leads us to the equity and inclusion that we see among our lending, which takes us to our next slide. So we have many different ways of tracking our outputs and outcomes in our work. We served over 1,400 entrepreneurs, helped the launch or growth of over 400 businesses. But some of this access to capital is incredibly important because we hear that from especially Black entrepreneurs that lack of access to capital is really what's holding them back. It's directly connected to the fact that the majority of Black-owned firms are sole proprietorships or have one or few, like one employee. And so we know that capital is essential. So we're proud that we, as of the end of 2022, had deployed $3.6 million in microloans. Those microloans had an average size of $22,000. And we're excited that 98% of our borrowers are people of color, mostly Black, Latinx, Asian and Arab entrepreneurs, which reflects the makeup of the city of Detroit and the areas we serve. We know that traditional banking institutions and even many CDFIs simply aren't reaching the community at that level. So how do we do that? Again, it really relates to that model, but ProsperUs can't take all the credit for that model. We actually adapted a model, and this brings us to our next slide. Of the Build From Within Alliance, we were actually the first adaptation of this model that came out of the Twin Cities, led by Mahilo Tamale and now Renee Dossman. That work we were the first to adapt the model. Since then, we've expanded, and there's now 16 partners across the country utilizing this comprehensive model, high-touch model of entrepreneurship support. And collectively between 2019 and 2021, you see that we're reaching almost 2,000 entrepreneurs through our training program, supporting access to capital at $8.2 million, and the outcomes go on. And so moving to the next slide, I just wanna share about the distinct and different diverse areas that this model is reaching. Literally from Anchorage, Alaska to Miami, Florida, urban and rural communities, many Black communities, but many immigrant communities, many low to moderate income communities that are able to tap into and use this model as a framework that's then adaptable to the local context and invest in the local community organizations. So there's a number of federal resources that we're looking at both within ProsperUs and across our national network. that I'm excited to share more about, but I'll dive into that more when we get to the question portion. But I'm so excited about how network-based approach, hub and spoke models create that ground level work that then provides access or the opportunity for accessing federal resources. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Chanell. Really appreciate that today for everything that you shared today. And excited to go, I think, continue to dive in a bit around this question of what does it really mean to center community? I'm gonna invite some of our other panelists to share in this. So Chanell, I'm gonna start with you. Because what I hear in this is that y'all been doing this, known this for a while. I think there are many folks on the call who are new to the work, right? Perhaps there are funders who haven't taken that sort of objective. Perhaps they don't have some of those existing relationships. Based on your experience, what would you recommend if you're seeking to center community in this work? What sort of tactics or strategies might you lift up?
Most definitely. I love this question because it gives me an opportunity to explain the value of grassroots level, organic, community-focused solutions that are of the community and built from within the community. We know that many times we're looking to reach scale. And because of that, we often find or invest in kind of top-down approaches, right? What's one place we can invest that's going to reach a broader geography or number of people? And that's important and wonderful, but I do encourage us to think about the both and here. I think that while top-down approaches can be effective, so can organized communities within a certain sector or even across sectors can also lead to that same effect. We're seeing that here in Detroit with our community development partners, but we're also building a similar hub and spoke framework across the state of Michigan. This hasn't been facilitated or initiated by any one funder or any government entity, but instead are passionate organizations with an understanding of our shared vision and our ability to position ourselves, organize ourselves, and create the infrastructure between and among each other so that we can be ready vehicles for investments. We're so excited to do that as it relates to small business in Detroit and across the state of Michigan. And then of course, at that national level that I just explained.
I appreciate that so much, Chanell. And also what I hear in that is this sort of network approach. Network approach that doesn't feel too dissimilar from what Kendra's doing in CEMI Valley as well. How do we think about bringing some of those options to the fore? Melanie, I'm actually gonna turn it to you. And I wanna talk a little bit about geography. I appreciate that you're working in the South. And as a Southerner, I realize rural North Carolina is very different than Atlanta, very different than Houston. What have you learned about sort of operating in some of these geographies? I would love to hear, I mean, there's a lot of folks from the rural perspective. And so leading with some of that, I think will be particularly insightful for folks.
Absolutely. Well, thank you for this question, John. And I think I'm gonna build off of what we heard from both Chanell and Kendra, that particularly in rural areas, networks and relationships are infrastructure. They are vital infrastructure that makes everyday life happen, but also for large undertakings like visioning and implementing, you know, the promise of the future that these programs can bring, they're vital as well. And so we started with an ecosystem in each of these places where we're working now, where we were funding folks that were already doing this work. Some of them were loosely connected. Some of them were already working tightly together. But for us, it was having that foothold, the investments in communities. And one of the questions I always ask when we're funding is who makes your work possible? And so I think often, particularly if you're an outsider funding in the South, funding in a rural community, asking those questions about who may be invisible or who you may not see because of your vantage point or because work looks different in your urban area was very, very vital and important to us. We have some non-conventional partners, I think, for a climate justice organization in rural areas. I think oftentimes you'll find a hospital as an anchor for us. We have a rural electric co-op that has been a willing anchor that had really great relationships with organizations in the community. What we know about this federal funding is that rural electric co-ops are like getting probably historic and more than they've ever seen in terms of federal funding. And you know, the amount of funding that is an opportunity for them is more than almost any investment we've seen in rural America, period. And so having those organizations as an anchor that understand the ins and outs of the community, that understand the challenges has been really, really vital to our work and to our success. One of the things that has often been, or has also been really, really important, is for folks to really take the time to understand, or for us to share information where folks are asking so that they can really understand, okay, what makes sense here? There are some programs that, you know, you have to have a population 200,000 or be in a metro area. And so really allowing folks to focus on what is for them and not be afraid, not have FOMO to miss out on things that may not be for their specific community. I think the other thing that was really important for us is that, you know, energy is really important, but you can't talk about energy without talking about homes. And housing stock in rural America is one of the key and core issues. And so even if folks say that they're not an expert on what energy should look like, they know what their home should look like. They know what the challenges are in their homes and their churches and their places of business. And so folks, our partners, particularly using that as an entry point, have been able to really not only see the interest and the desire that people have for their own communities and be able to set their own priorities, but have also been able to come together across sector. Because if you're thinking about health, you're thinking about housing. Economic mobility, you're thinking about housing. If you're thinking about schooling, you're thinking about housing. And so that's been vital, and it's really stretched us to be more fluent in these conversations and to enter them or make sure that there's an entry point for folks that may not have been traditional climate and energy. And fortunately for us at the Hive Fund, that's always been our approach, that one or two of our grantee partners may have climate or energy in their name, but we know that this is an issue and these are issues that affect everyone. And so we look for multi-solvers, because if you can get folks to show up at a PTA meeting and understand the importance and show up there, then you can also pull folks together for this vital, vital issue and help to organize how they'll implement it as a community.
I mean, what I hear in that is you're doing power building. That is the way that we start and strengthen some of these relationships. If you want to get to a community, I'm loving the who makes your work possible. There's been a few quotables across the three of you all throughout today, but I'm hearing the who makes your work possible, and that this starts with, we call it capacity building, call it education, call it what you want to, but it's investing in the relationships and ensuring that folks are armed with the information to make progress. How do we think about both of those fronts? I realize I did that for the Southeast. Kendra, I'd love to turn with you. You know, we hear a lot about California, and I imagine working in the Inland Empire is very different than working in LA, very different than the Bay Area, yet you still have this statewide catchment area. How are you thinking about similar questions? How does this work vary from geography to geography?
So you know, the thing about CEMI, and that's kind of the sweet spot for SURF and CEMI working together, are the regions. So the 13 regions really represent Californians, because every region is different. Every region has, you know, issues and needs. For example, mentioning the Inland Empire, San Bernardino area, going into almost into the Mojave Desert, there's a lot of climate issues. In fact, what's interesting is that they just discovered plutonium, I believe it's plutonium, in the borax mines. And it's enough for the rest of our lives. And so the climate impact in that region, which is very under-resourced, is, you know, going to have a lot of challenges going forward. And so, you know, which is very different than the North Valley, the Fresno area, which is more, you know, strong ag. But there's flooding. There's a lot of issues around the farm workers. The Bay Area is in San Francisco in particular, which is also very different from Oakland. And so really, you know, my work, which is, you know, understanding those needs. And so the support that we are working with on the ground is to make sure that that it's real to them. One of the things we did not dictate to in our application process is we didn't want those barriers that tend to be in applying for capacity building money. So we really had an application you could fill out in under 2 hours. We don't have a heavy reporting period. You know, we really wanted the time, and that's really what our capacity building application process is, to give them back time to better focus on what you need in the region. And so, you know, it is buying hopefully the time to be at the table. And, you know, each of our regions at our application period We had over 475 applications, which is pretty unprecedented. And they all, we have 58 counties in California, and we received applications from 57. One of them, I still don't quite, Mariposa, and I always call them out because I don't understand it. That's where Yosemite is. It's really interesting that that one particularly, but it told us a lot about what the needs were. They were so different, dynamic. We have the largest tribal, we have more tribes in California than in the country. And so it is definitely a core part of the work that we're doing as well. And they're very, and the tribes in every region are very, very different. They have different needs. And so as a native Californian, it is fascinating to me what the geographic needs are and how this is going to be really an exercise in how collaboratives and collectives and those partners, as we've been talking about partners, really change the way they've been doing with a grassroots community. It tends to be very out of sight, out of mind because of the capacity. Our nonprofits just don't have that level. And it's not because they don't want to. It's just that we've not really taken a step back to make sure that they have. And so it is really a breath of fresh air for the public-private partnerships that we are working with, and as well, especially the state, because the state sometimes gets money and they're very hands-off. And the process is designed and you go for it. And that's not the case at all. So we hope to see really our regions changing.
Yeah, I so appreciate that, Kendra. And I think the part of what you got to in the end of that is this, what is it like from the nonprofit partners to be exposed to this opportunity? How do you think about a bit of that pivot? When you do the work, you are focused on doing the work, and the idea of making this pivot to now engage with policymakers, engage with broader networks, that's a pivot. Chanell, I remember we talked about this a little bit of how you're navigating it. And I imagine there are other nonprofit folks on the line who are used to doing the work. What advice would you have for folks? And not suggest that broader policy engagement network is not also the work, but what additional advice or reflections would you have to nonprofits looking to make a similar pivot?
Yeah, I've had such a fun and illuminating crash course on policy advocacy over the last year and a half to 2 years. You know, I was busy building our CDFI, which we got certified in February of 2021. And so very quickly, thank you. Very quickly though, we were seeing that new resources were available and coalitions were forming in many different areas, but especially around some of the CDFIs in Detroit and in Michigan. But what I noticed was that just like I described on that funnel, in order to get entrepreneurs from low to moderate income backgrounds and often entrepreneurs of color to access capital, there's all this additional support leading in. And yet those groups weren't organized. Those groups are literally in one-to-one conversations, knocking on doors on the retail corridors. And so we are really fortunate to have a wonderful governor and lieutenant governor here in Michigan. Shout out to Governor Gretchen Whitmer, who started talking to business support organizations, as well as the financing institutions, as well as all different sectors, to start to understand what they need to be doing as policy implementers and policymakers. And so we started off as a one-time discussion, the statewide group that I'm now leading, and very quickly, we realized that we have a shared vision. We've been doing similar work in our respective communities and separate areas. And I brought to the group, along with another key partner of mine, what if we were to keep meeting together? What if we were to design some policy recommendations? And we did that. And that took about 6 months. We got some support from a key foundation. And quickly that snowballed, right, from general policy recommendations for our state leadership to, what if we were to form a hub and spoke model statewide? Could we be the first ever networked approach to small business support that engages not just the technical assistance providers, but also those trusted connectors and communities, much like Melanie was sharing, those who might not do business support or TA, but are the connectors in their communities and know the business owners and the emerging business owners and are a key resource. And so very soon after that, we developed our proposal for what this statewide initiative could look like. So having shared all that, my recommendation is to be in conversation, to take that time. And I was hesitant, right? I was like, another roundtable, another coalition. It really has to be worth that investment. And everyone's time, right? But when you find those who are as committed and rooted in community, it's worth it to begin to collaborate on a bigger vision and infrastructure to create that vision. And then to tap into the resources beyond those grassroots level organizations, tap into the funders and the funding networks that are supportive of efforts of this kind, and stay in close connection and build conversation with local, state, and federal agencies that are interested and have both resources or simply advice that can help build and strengthen the coalitions that we're working on. So I think that investment of time, even if it doesn't end up leading to maybe the resources that we hope to support, what it will do is strengthen our practice, right? Our community of practice is stronger and more established and will be more resourced because of the way we can now collaborate where we weren't collaborating in the same way before.
Mm-hmm. So much of that resonates. And I hear sort of the funder in me here is, if you just create space for folks to gather, they will often figure out what needs to happen. How are we making intentional spaces for folks to collaborate and convene in this way? I actually want to pivot and ask the reverse of this question. And maybe I'll start with Kendra, but I'm coming to you ultimately too, Melanie. So study up, which is, how do we, Chanell's thoughts are around, what's the role of nonprofits? We have a good bit of state economic development agencies, folks who are sitting in governor's offices responsible for facilitating philanthropy. Kendra, you said you're meeting with the state government in California regularly. What advice would you have to government officials looking to do this work well, both at the state and or the local level?
Well, you know, one of the things that I'm impressed with the team that we are working with in California is the fact that they have reimagined what this is. And I think far often in our state governments, it's bureaucratic, it's process, because it's federal money. People, you know, it's an automatic kind of deal. And, you know, the fact that I have a monthly meeting that actually progresses every single month to a new level in California. Again, I can't even begin to tell you. I've been in the space for over 25 years, very specifically in housing policy work. And it's incredible. And so what I would say is, hopefully you are assigned to the motivated staff that is really working with the elected, because it's politics, that really is ready to move. And that is, I think we're lucky, that it's been very organic in our sense. And I think just because realizing we can't continue to do things the same way. And that's the other thing. We all realize that. I'm not blaming. And one of the things that really has come up in our group is it's about trusting government. And so many of our partners don't trust. And I think that we in our space, we've been talking about, how do we really, how do we work with that message? Because there's the state level, and then there's the regional, and then there's the local, and they're also very different. I imagine in other states here politically, there's districts that are, very progressive. There are areas that are not. The rural communities in California are so different. And so how do you make that work together at the end of the day? With the SERF community, very specifically, the communities that they so often have not been working with, how do you build that trust? And that is a message and a brand that I'm really proud to be leading, but they have to be trusted partners, which means they have to hear stuff they don't want to hear. And some of those regions, especially those leaders in the region, have been, very much, if you ask them to put together an economic include, a plan for economy, for transportation, they can do it like that. But if you talk about that in a red line community and how you build resiliency, they want to take 2 years. And we're like, no, that's because you haven't been partnering. That's because you don't have, you're not that connected. And the beautiful thing is we can have those real conversations. Now, everybody doesn't want to hear it, but that is what it takes in order for the government, the public sector, to be trusted in this moment, because people can't dream, you know, for lack of a better word. They can't reimagine anything if the day they don't feel like they're going to be heard.
So much of that resonates on a few different levels. You shared a lot about from a state perspective. Melanie, I'd love to hear from you. What have you seen at the local level? I'm thinking of some of the work in Atlanta, or perhaps in New Orleans is what's coming to mind for me. But oftentimes we talk about these considerations. I'd love to hear, do you have any examples of what good looks like? Do you think that there's anyone that is doing this well that we would lift up other than CEMI? Where else do we say, where else is good?
Yeah, Kendra, thanks so much for your wonderful work. I do want to pick up on something that you introduced, which is this idea that this is really about people's faith in government and their ability to be able to trust government to deliver for them. And so that's why it's been so critical for us in each place that we fund to continue to fund our advocacy, our civic engagement groups that have always been a part of our work as part of this infrastructure and part of these coalitions that we're seeing in place. A couple of things stand out to me in this moment. One, I think that we've got communities that have been planned to death. They're like a plan for a plan for a plan for a plan for a plan. And what they really want to see, what they require in this moment to have that faith or to build or restore some of that faith, is to actually see dollars on the ground, to see projects in their communities in the way that they've called for them. And so I think one of the things that governments are gonna have to do differently, and we've seen folks taking some steps, is prioritizing what communities have already asked for, because there are plans that are on the shelf that can be dusted off, maybe aligned to what specific projects are calling for, what grant projects are calling for, and move forward just like that. And so communities don't wanna feel like their time is being wasted or they're given the runaround. They need to see dollars on the ground. Some of the things that we're seeing, and I can talk about Houston and Atlanta. I'll say one thing that's been really critical is for us funding a person. And Houston is probably the place where we're furthest ahead. When I've been in conversations with EPA, staff, and also with local communities where they're like, is what we need to be able to really engage with communities is a person who can do some of the work, do some of the help prioritizing, bringing voices together, convening. And so we have a person on the ground in Houston, we're hiring one in Atlanta that are doing that work so that there's an actual person whose job it is to make sure that what's coming from the coalition is getting connected to these places, that those voices are being lifted up, that if there are insights and folks want to make comments on a public comment period for the way that the program is being designed, that they can sift through what folks are hearing and, you know, implement that as well. When we were in conversation, we were with the sustainability director of Atlanta. And, you know, I think that there are folks that are trying really, really hard to figure out how we do this differently in a system that is set up for basically the best resourced organizations to get contracts. What does that look like? If it's hard to sell the city council on a procurement that's not going to come with a revolving loan fund that's already attached to it. And so I think that's one of the questions for philanthropy. Can we be some of that infrastructure that means that new and emerging businesses, that businesses that are MBE, that are minority businesses, women-owned businesses that have not traditionally been able to get these contracts are able to because they have some of that infrastructure or those attachments that come with having historically received federal or even local government funding? And so those are questions that we're asking in conversations that we're in with local governments right now. And then I think one of the other things that we've heard from folks that are in the government is that they need a lot of help and support. So I'm deeply, deeply grateful to groups like Southeast Sustainability Directors Network that is having regular calls and providing information and even playbooks and models for local government folks. But then the other piece is for rural communities who don't have a sustainability director. Again, needing to fund that person or else connections to some of these rural networks that are providing that TA, because it's going to be critical for everyone to level up to be able to make the most of this opportunity.
Chanell, I saw you come off mute. Were you going to chime in there?
Yeah, well, Melanie said many things that resonate with me, but I wanted to just draw a little dotted line to the work that CDFIs are doing, right? some CDFIs have been in the clean energy space for a long time, but many have not. And yet the opportunities to really work at that intersection are right here in front of us. So, you know, we're looking at the Greenhouse Gas Reduction Act, and I want to uplift the work of the African American Alliance of CDFIs, CEOs, as well as the Community Builders of Color Coalition that they are leading, focus on illuminating the places and means for which CDFIs can play a role in creating energy efficiency and green infrastructure through its lending to community businesses and to community residents. So, you know, I think I'm excited to explore, you know, what I see as like missed opportunities to this point, and to have resources to now kind of meet that need. We have business owners that could be well prepared to install solar at a residential or community level. I want them to be a part of that. And the Clean Communities Investment Accelerator. We could build energy efficiency into every loan that moves into a brick and mortar space in Detroit. We're not doing that yet, but I think that the opportunity is right there. And so with the right resources and technical assistance, both to our organization and to the business owners we serve, we're able to move the needle and engage communities of color in clean energy in a way that, you know, I almost see it as a way we haven't even had the privilege to even think about it yet, but we can, and those opportunities are right there. So I'm just so excited for what Melanie's doing with the Hive Fund and what Kendra you're doing with CEMI, because it's a great example and connected to what we're doing here in Detroit, even though our lens is small business support.
And I'm wondering if I can hop back, because I'm feeling yes. Thank you so much, Chanell, for that and for lifting up. I swell with pride because, you know, we fund the African American Alliance for CDFI CEOs, and we're able to help fund them to start the Community Builders of Color Coalition. And so we're really excited about what it means to be in this space that, as you said, like oftentimes we haven't had this time to think about. And before I was at the Hive Fund, I worked at the Mary Reynolds Babcock Foundation, where I supported a lot of rural investment. And it's so interesting because I often hear that CDFIs have not funded in this green energy space. And I just think about the number of loans that I approved and the number of projects that I saw come through CDFIs that we were supporting with general operating support that had, you know, stormwater systems, that had energy efficiency. There's not a hospital or a library that's been built in the last 10 years in rural America that did not think about these things from a cost perspective. And so we've also really been pushing folks to say, okay, what does it look like to look at your inventory of what you've already done and reframe it and shift it to saying that you actually have been doing this green investment, you have been doing this green lending. It may not have had that tag to it, but, you know, we have this infrastructure, we have this history of doing that work. And so I'm really, really excited and so happy that you called that out, but also about the opportunity, particularly in these communities that have long been bypassed. I try not to get on the soapbox, but I talk a lot about, you know, a lot of these products for energy efficiency or for green homes or for low to moderate income families. And we have entirely missed the low. We have missed the L. And so what I talk about, this is often like a race to the L. What does it look like to really be able to service the low income communities, low income families, residential dwellings that for so long has just been kind of left out of the products that are going to the market.
I want to actually pull from the chat, and I encourage folks, not the chat, but in the Q&A. So panelists, we have a colleague in the background that's looking at what's showing up in the Q&A and pushing things up. And there's been this question around accountability, right? We're talking about what does it look like to include community in planning, a critical step. And this is not first merry-go-round, right? We've been through these planning processes and seen what it looks like when community gets left out. I realize we are early in this process to some extent, but what reflections do you all have about how do you hold folks accountable to actually the outcome side and not just the planning side? Any thoughts? I realize that's a big question. Kendra, you want to get us started?
Yeah, you know, that's really a core part of CEMI. It's our grant making, it's our technical assistance, and it's our power building. And we kind of, and with that, you know, the focus is really accountability. It's after, you know, building that power. So there is accountability far and beyond, you know, when the dates have passed and the money is gone and we're in a new era. And so for us in California, and so often, you know, the tie, you know, both Melanie and Chanell were saying, is having the people at the table who can be in those meetings when when comments need to be made, when maybe monies weren't given or budgets aren't equal. And so, you know, that's what we really are hoping that the power building work that we're wanting to implement really will focus on accountability. And hopefully, again, we continue to have people at the table who have time. I know, just, you know, really briefly, an experience for me, I just come from the housing policy area. And so often that the communities that were redlined never had people to be able to participate fully. An example, in my region, in the Sacramento area, actually where I live and have been doing a lot of work, the county supervisor meetings are at 9 a.m. So, you know, who can participate in that? Not many people. And so that's the level. I mean, that's the micro we're looking at to ensure, you know, the counties get more money than the cities in California. And so they have a bigger purse that they need to be accountable for. But if you can't make a meeting at 9 o'clock for accountability at 9 a.m. and you don't really have those partners in the coalition in place or the knowledge of what's on the agenda, you miss, you know, opportunities. And so that's really what we want to make sure, you know, from every county and every region in California. I really am passionate about that because I was in that space and I know what it takes to be there, and it's a lot.
Melanie, Chanell, other thoughts you might offer up on this? How do we think about this accountability component, not just on the front end planning component?
Yeah, I think it's so important that we do when we start out, and I know we're talking about like on the back end, but in order to get there where the outcomes are there on the back end, we need to, at the beginning, look at who's at the table and what results have they already produced? What outcomes are they already facilitating in their communities? I think we need to tap into and leverage and expand the capabilities of organizations that already have a track record of doing the work, of being in community, of you know, bringing resources to the community level in an equitable way. And then when we have those organizations at the table, and as we're moving forward, I think we have to have intentionality around the systems we utilize, especially when we're talking about a hub and spoke model and multiple partners. What are the systems and the, you know, the technology tools that allow us to have common metrics, common methods for collecting data, ensuring that we have an equitable approach to data and that we're not bringing, and there always will be bias, but that we're at least aware of where those biases may exist in our data collection and then in our storytelling. And then, you know, kind of on the back end, when the work is done, really having that thorough analysis and valuing both that quantitative and that qualitative data, understanding what the community members are saying about the resources that were brought to the community, so that for the next time, we're even more equipped to see the outcomes reach and serve community in that meaningful way.
I think what Kendra and Chanell have offered are exactly right. They're spot on. I'll say, just offer two things. One, I think we've seen, particularly with some of the local infrastructure where folks are clear, are prioritizing specific programs that they know are going to be important for their communities, some accountability already. I'm thinking about EPA, I think the Climate Pollution Reduction Act required local governments and states to submit a notice of intent to apply. And I know in one of our jurisdictions, we were waiting and did not see that the jurisdiction had submitted. And so, you know, one of our partners actually called, like, hey, we're looking, making sure that you all are going to do this. And so that's an accountability measure on the front end to make sure that those funds, that communities are eligible for those funds that they deserve. But I do think that having this infrastructure, in addition to what Chanell and Kendra have already offered, and having some focus, knowing that unless, you know, there could be new infrastructure that is focused at accountability or watchdog, but in the absence of that, then knowing that, okay, this is going to be vital for us. We're going to be watching this. We're going to be tracking it and being public about it, whether it is through your regular meetings with your local officials or in some other way, is one way to let people know that you're watching, and folks are much more likely to behave in ways or to be transparent about what's going on when they know that folks are watching, and watching not just once, but coming back and back.
Continuing to pull from the chat, there's this question. I think your quotable, Melanie, around moving from shovel worthy to shovel ready is resonating with folks, but also a recognition that when I'm sitting at a state government level seat, I don't always have the flexibility to be able to go for the small, newer nonprofit, right? My risk assessment will end up eliminating a set of folks. As I think about that, there could be a role for philanthropy. Sort of what advice would you all have? Kendra, I see you shaking your head as well. I open this up to both of you. For the state government official who feels like they're in that seat, like, yep, I want to do exactly what you're saying, but my restrictions will prevent me from being able to engage that way. What advice would you have to that individual, or what would you sort of recommend to local philanthropic partners there?
Well, I'm happy to start, and then Kendra, I'm happy to hear your thoughts as well. I think there are a few things. One, for us, that is why this is the time. Someone also asked a question about the timeline. I've been on a 3-month, we're gonna extend a little bit, but really this 3 to 6 months is a time for philanthropy to invest now so that folks can be building up their staff and really, really get ready for, you know, the work that's gonna need to happen. If there are organizations that you know that have the potential to scale and grow through this moment, now is the time to invest in them. General operating multi-year support. We're looking at a 3-year, we're looking to 2026. And so if you can make that support 3 years, then that would do a whole lot for that organization and help it to be able to show up in ways that make sense. And if you can fund folks, this is also another question. You all have great questions right now, but fund folks so that they can show up in those coalition spaces, because that is staff time, or else fund stipends so that folks from community can get there, maybe both. That's gonna be vital as well. I think a couple of other things that I would say if you're our government is that some of the programs are actually designed specifically for smaller nonprofits that need to build capacity. I'm thinking about EPA's Thriving Communities program. Right now, they are selecting their re-granters who will actually be putting the federal dollars out so that folks won't have to interface with the federal government directly to receive those funds. But there are a portion of those dollars are set aside so that up to $75,000 are specifically for groups, expressly for groups that have never gotten federal funds before, that need to build their capacity, that are smaller nonprofits. So larger nonprofits can't get it. You will not be competing with them. It is specifically and expressly for you. And so I would say that if you're a state or a city government, then going through some of the different different programs and seeing what already, you know, carves out some funding for that makes sense. And then, you know, be in conversation with your philanthropic partners, but you can also model that in your state. And your criteria, you can say, hey, we want to have this much money set aside for emerging organizations. And this is what it looks like. This is what, you know, that program looks like. And so where you have space to shape your criteria for the funding that comes through the state and the city, you can do that as well. So follow that's one good model from the federal government that I think folks should be following.
Kendra, what else might you add?
I would definitely say I concur 100% what Melanie said. And, you know, one of the things that our foundation is doing, that's part of what the center is, we're a 501c3. And so we have actually the capacity to partner with the state and the feds, but mostly with the state of California, to be a grant partner. And so one of the benefits that we have is kind of using a muscle, if you will, in granting, so many of this money is going to be reimbursement based, and so many of the partners cannot afford, and we've seen in what has happened during this pandemic is so many nonprofits took that on, and it really put them in a bigger hardship because they had to use so much of their other money for this money. And then, you know, the reimbursement process is still like it was, you know, 75 years ago. And so what we do is actually we try to be a buffer. That's what we offer. And so if you have foundations in your region or partners that can do it, I highly suggest that. I actually have two state contracts underneath my portfolio that are tied to the CARES Act monies. And we gave many of the partners money up front, which we were able to do that. We could leverage that. Especially it was around mortgage as a program called CMRP around mortgage protection. It was very specific to homeowners. And so they wouldn't go in foreclosure. And then there was another program that the state had through EDD, which is our unemployment entity. And it was very specific for people who were impacted by the pandemic for the very non-traditional languages, maybe traditional Mexican Spanish, for more of the indigenous Spanish. So it was a language program. And we also facilitated and worked with the state with that. And so, you know, we're going to have to bulk up and be bigger. As a matter of fact, my CEMI is going to be partnering at a level as it relates to more technical assistance and so on. And so I think it would be great for coalitions to approach your foundations to consider this, to get the money on the ground fast. Because you will have grassroots organizations who may not be at the, you know, 5 million, you know, the question often is, you know, do you have a budget of $5 million? Well, that turns people off automatically. And so, you know, being in position to do that. And I think it has just been amazing that we've been able to do that. Because I will tell you this, in that space, like we partner with an agency called Moss Adams to help us with compliance. That's a real world word with real money. All of you may, you know what that is as it relates to this money, because it's so unique that they're really watching in ways that they, I guess, traditionally don't, but even more so. So the oversight is intense. And so you have to have a team that can really do this. And so we have that infrastructure, and I would highly suggest it because there's still this. We're getting $190 billion. You know, if the nonprofit sector got $45 billion of that, and I'm being, you know, that which is a lot of money. So the infrastructure on the ground just cannot take that. And so, you know, quickly, like in this cycle, try to, you know, contract and partner with a foundation, a trusted foundation that leads with community. That's what we do. I can't suggest that any more than trying to find that sooner than later.
I so appreciate the specificity of what you all are naming, right? Like, yes, you can do general operating support. Yes, you can do technical assistance, but there's a whole suite of other things. Fund the position, right? How do you provide this backstop funding? We know that sort of reimbursements have been a challenge across the board. How do we get ahead of these types of opportunities? Philanthropy is designed to be this flexible funding. How do we create more of those opportunities? Really feels critical. I'm looking at time. And sadly, we do have to wind this convo down. But I want to talk about a piece that we haven't actually discussed much throughout today's conversation, which is the role of corporates, right? In our opening slide, we named that a good chunk of this work will be private tax incentives. Melody, you spoke about the role of community benefit agreements and sort of what that will mean, you know, as one way that we start to hold corporates accountable. We're hoping to do another one of these sessions where we actually bring some corporate folks to the fore. More to come on that soon, but I'd love to sort of close out to hear from you all. What reflections would you all have to corporates in this moment? I even see someone from a bank sort of asking, what can we do? How do we better support community builders of color and other efforts? So answer that question directly or more broadly. And I think I'll start this one with Kendra, then with Chanell, and then Melanie. Role of corporations. What do you want folks to be thinking about in this moment?
So I saw that from U.S. Bank, and I'm happy to see that because U.S. Bank just did a merger and $100 billion community benefits agreement, which I actually was a participant of. So I'm happy to see U.S. Bank reaching out and very, very specific in community. And I would say that those relationships are important. I think corporations are realizing that this is going to be a coalition. We understand, you know, that they have a role. This is a capitalistic society. At the same time, that you don't lose by partnering with community. At the end of the day, as Melanie and Chanell, you know, the small businesses, the entrepreneurs, at the end of the day, the engine of who we are in this country and in our states and our regions are going to be tied to corporate money and private dollars. And so how do you build trust and relationships with that? Being clear about what you can and can't do, and having partners at the table. If I could just for 1 second kind of go off a little bit, is it's hard for nonprofit organizations when you're supported by corporations many times, and you might have a conflict of interest in the sense that, you know, what they do and what you're advocating for don't really match. And so making sure that your partners, you know, because that's where the trust that you build is the corporations that you're not going to leverage who you are. I think that's important, and really not, you know, partnering somebody who understands that and won't require you to leverage that. I think it's critically important. But I think there's plenty of opportunity in this moment. And that the more you have your, especially with the banks, the more you have a relationship and build partners with them, I think the better opportunities to work together and to move forward together.
Now, what would you add?
Yeah, so we have many corporate partners through corporate giving, through corporate foundations, and they have been wonderful support to our work. We see our relationship in that ProsperUs can often help entrepreneurs reach a certain point, but then there's gonna be a point where they're beyond our services and can be a relationship with a banking partner or another corporation could be really helpful for that entrepreneur's success. So I think that at times there can be alignment in, you know, why we exist and how we can also collaborate with our corporate partners. A few ways that we've partnered with corporations. One is simple. If there's grants available, we love to use grant capital for lending. It ensures that we're as flexible and able to reach entrepreneurs that have the quote unquote most risky kind of deals. And, you know, and that's for some corporate partners and not for others, but it's a wonderful and very useful opportunity for organizations supporting small businesses. Also, corporate giving can often be utilized as matching funds for federal opportunities. We've seen that with our SBA Prime Award, providing technical assistance. The matching dollars came from our partnership with JPMorgan Chase. And, you know, I think that many corporations often have systems and infrastructure that can really benefit both individual nonprofits as well as networks of nonprofits, utilizing their tools or even skilled volunteers. That's something we did to build out our CRM. And so that support has been both financial, but also, you know, other kinds of resources that strengthen our organization. And so to the corporations, or sorry, team members from corporations, I encourage you to reach out to the organizations that you're interested in. Whether if you have a national approach, find the national alliances and coalitions working to build in the industry or sector that align well with the strategic priorities of your organization. And maybe be open to the different types of support. I think there's so many that are ready and able to utilize and partner with you. And so I'm sure there's an opportunity to uncover that can really elevate the, you know, the mission and purpose of your corporation while also uplifting the mission of the nonprofits and those coalitions that they work within.
Thanks for that, Chanell. Go for it, Melanie.
Yes, I'll underscore everything that's already been shared. One thing that feels vital is for businesses, be they corporate or other types of businesses, because there's this requirement for community engagement or community benefits, we have heard from our partners that they are just getting bombarded with emails, calls for folks who want them to sign on as community partners. The one biggest thing that you can do is not get to know someone when you need them to be your community partner. And so to actually take the time to build real relationships to see what makes sense and if you all are are in alignment in terms of values, in terms of vision, and in terms of what you hope to get done, because this is a quite a small window of time. And so if you sign on for partnerships or casting the net really wide without actually trying to build that relationship, then that can actually stunt the ability to make the most of these funds, because we have about 3 years. And that is not a lot of time, as anyone who's ever worked on a project from planning to actual completion knows. And so that's the one thing that I would add to what's already been said here, in addition to, you know, if you got funds, now's the time for your foundation to invest as well.
I so appreciate the richness of this conversation. And I think I want to lift up that there are a few resources on the FSG website that get at a few of these conversations. How do we think about corporates engaging community effectively? How do we think about different mechanisms for coming together at a shared table? Some of the fundamentals of collective impact. We even think about some of our older work around community, our community engagement toolkit, ways of actually looking at that table and seeing who's around that table, who's gathered. How do we start to think about those? Again, we're dropping resource lists in the chat, but with only a few minutes left, I think I'm charged with wrapping us up today. I wanna do a huge thank you to Melanie, Kendra, and Chanell for bringing us together. I think you all did not disappoint on any level, from my opinion at least, the richness of the conversation, the ability to hear the different perspectives, but in so many ways, really shared perspectives. I think what I'm leaving from this conversation is some hope. These feel like huge numbers, feels like a really daunting opportunity. And I think the practical solutions that you all brought forward, the real-time ideas, what you're seeing and learning has been invaluable. So I wanna do a huge thank you again. Thank you to everyone who joined today. We will be sharing all of the slides, including contact information for our presenters, all of their content that's on those slides, as well as the resource list. All that will be emailed to you. And you, of course, can have my contact information. All that will be shared. With that, I think we are going to close out today. And again, I want to say a huge thank you again to Melanie, Kendra, and Chanell. Thank you all for joining us. We're excited to continue the conversation, to keep it going. Hope you all have a great rest of the afternoon today. Thanks so much, folks.